Good morning. Welcome to Hebron Lutheran Church. We welcome you this morning, as we invite you, viewing here on Facebook streaming or perhaps on YouTube. We want to reach out and let you know that if there's anything we can do for you, service-wise, by helping out with maybe some financial help or any needs, please contact our office here at Hebron. Anybody that lives in the Boone County area that we can assist you with. Everything should be published right there at the bottom of the screen. Especially during this pandemic, if you need any kind of food assistance and utility bill, we'd be glad to help you. So with that, let's open our service and begin with our greeting, all right? Well, I say that, but I lost my page. Oh, here we are. And we have those websites right there. Great. Welcome. So I'd like to open up with your Jesus.
Bless the Lord, my soul, oh my. is a mystery, how you gently lift me when I am surrounded. Your love carries me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah.
Makes me sing. Church family and our friends and our neighbors, because you designed us this way, Father.
We're so discontent and we struggle to find meaning, but we're frustrated and we're angry and sometimes we're hopeless. But as we join together in prayer right now, each one of us with different burdens, different struggles and feelings and thoughts, we ask that you transform us and allow us to have the mind of Christ. Help us to follow through with what we know you would want for us to accomplish each day as we're alone. Help us to put our neighbor first. Allow us to let our faith shine out even in these dark times when everything feels strange. Father, you're exalted above the heavens and the earth, yet you care for the most lowly of your people. And we praise you for your compassion. We ask you to open our eyes for the needy and the downcast as well. God, we lift up all those in need. We pray for our world, each and every soul. We pray for a vaccine to be discovered and a treatment for all suffering with the virus. We pray for all those with other illnesses who may feel forgotten during this time when we're obsessing over this COVID-19. Father, we pray for everyone who's serving in this battle, the medical teams, the government, the teachers, military. We pray for mothers and fathers and grandparents and children and caregivers of children who are scared and confused. Father, we pray that we'll all lean on the promise of heaven and truth for your word and your way. We thank and praise you for everything that you give us, especially for the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ. And we lift our hearts and our minds and our eyes to you now. And we put all our focus on you, Lord, on everything that you are to us and everything that you give us. Though not one of us is worthy of receiving what you offer. We praise you for your great deeds, which you draw our attention to you. Make us want to be like you. So we pray to you, Father, the author and giver of life, our sovereign Lord, for the paths to be made obvious for us. And we pray for life-giving spirit behind all that we do so that our efforts will not be in vain. Hold us close, walk with us always, and help us to go out into the world being your servants. In Jesus Christ's holy name, we pray.
There is a candle in every soul, some brightly burning, some dark. Brings a fire, ignites a candle, and makes a home. So carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the hopeless, confused and torn. Hold out your candle. Without a flame, so carry your candle.
Good morning and welcome. That is a tremendous blessing and welcome that we received this morning with the music by our praise and worship. I'm Wally Lewis. I'm a member of a Hebron Lutheran Church here. I'm on the council, and I also work with outreach, and I've been asked to deliver today's message. So before I get started, I would like to open up with a prayer. Father, I know I'm an individual called to love others as Christ has loved me, because the life of the church is enriched by my servanthood. Send me into the world in your name. I seek your help that you have promised. May my words be your words. Allow all to hear your message you put into me to deliver this day. Share and give thanks to you, I pray in your name, Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, that last song that we were blessed to hear, Go Light Your Candle, it means a lot to me. It's become like a little bit of a theme song. I feel that we all are that light, and we need to be that light. Let's help those others that are in need. So with that, my message for today is, let's take a walk. Yes, the title of this message is, let's take a walk. So when you're walking, you can never have both feet on the ground at the same time. Your body is in motion. And we know the saying, a body in motion stays in motion, right? This is part of being healthy. With the recent social distancing and the closing of many places, I've noticed a lot of people walking today. The weather is getting better, and it's getting to be a lot nicer out. I've noticed people in my neighborhood walking more. People I haven't seen in a long time. People I don't even know. I've seen them walking with their dogs, their cats, and pet rabbits around our neighborhood. All this is done with one step at a time. I've wondered about those that can't get out and physically walk because of their age, or maybe it's a disability, or maybe it's the lack of encouragement. I found a few different ways to keep myself physically active. I've mentioned this. I sit in a lazy boy. I arm and leg, back and forth in my recliner. I've got the remote control going on. I've got the curl up behind the back, curl. So what about our spiritual workout? What about our daily walk with our spiritual life? Just like the physical walk, you can do this by yourself or you can do this with others. It is also done one step at a time. We learn to crawl and then walk and then run. Again, I'm speaking about the spiritual walk that I'm talking about here. Growing and developing into what God has created us to be. The word tells us that God took a walk in the garden one day, and man and woman hid from him. Since that day, we've tried to keep our balance. One step in this worldly kingdom, or trying to keep one step in the godly kingdom. One foot. This being the third Sunday of Easter, we have our first lesson coming from the book of Acts. So let me give you a little bit of a summary as we approach this. Jesus has risen from the dead. After 3 days, the two ladies, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, find the tomb empty. This word spreads to the disciples and throughout the whole community. Jesus then spends the next 40 days walking and appearing and revealing himself to those disciples and a lot of others. Jesus ascended to the Father. Jesus gives us the peace and comfort. He's also promised us a great advocate. He's promised us the Holy Spirit. In the book of Acts, that was written by the Apostle Luke, spoken by the Apostle Peter and the other disciples, there were about 120 of them at about this time in the book of Acts, chapter 2, as they were gathered together. It's about 50 days after the Passover. This is a day of Pentecost, a day of harvest is what was recognized. They were staying in Jerusalem, again, on that day of Pentecost. Now a wind from heaven comes down blowing and fills this whole house that they're staying in. These little fires are seen on top of their heads. They look like little tongues. They just seem to be little tongues of fire. Powerful, powerful. So powerful that they start to fall outside and speak in languages that only certain people that knew the dialect understood, but multiple people. They heard this and saw what was taking place. These God-fearing Jews from every nation, they were bewildered. They were thinking these guys had way too much wine by 9 o'clock in the morning. This is where I pick up in Acts 2, verse 14. The words of Peter. But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. Therefore, let the entire house of Israel know with certainty that God has made him both Lord and Messiah, this Jesus whom you sacrificed. This is a proclamation by Peter. It is gospel. It is good news. Peter goes on and tells them that how the prophecies are being fulfilled and has been fulfilled. Look in Joel as he explains, chapter 2, the 28th verse. And afterward I will pour out my spirit and on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will have dreams. Your young men will see visions. When they heard this, what Peter was telling them, we're going to verses 37 and 38. Now, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the other apostles, brothers, what should we do? Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus, so that your sins may be forgiven and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Repent means to turn and go the other way. Turn from the wrong and go the right way. Peter goes on to tell us about this fellowship and this relationship. Continue on in verse 39, he says, for the promise is for you, for your children, and for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord our God calls on to. We are called for more. We are made for more. The simple instructions, Jesus was to make disciples. That's what he tells us. The Great Commission coming from Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 through 20. It's our calling. This is what we should be doing, especially to those that don't know. Peter continues to testify. Continuing in Acts chapter 2, the 40th verse and 41st verse, it says, and he testified with many other arguments and exhorted them, saying, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. So those who welcomed his message were baptized, and that day about 3,000 persons were added. Wow, that's a good day. The first sermon is given by Peter, the first New Testament church. The Apostolic Church. It was devoted to praying and teaching and fellowship. The Acts 2 Church. Are we there yet? Where are you at today? Are you at home? Or are you walking, watching this on your iPhone or your Android? recently I've read a book titled Disciples That Fits. It's authored by Bobby Harrington and Alex Absalom. And here's a quote that I'd like to read to you from this book. It says, "The church as a whole has not always understood the correlation between evangelism and discipleship. This misunderstanding has given rise to churches producing large numbers of converts with little depth, converts who could hardly be called disciples of Jesus Christ. These churches are often said to be great at evangelism, but poor at discipleship. Conversely, there are also many churches that emphasize great teaching and theological depth, but fail to see God use them to bring very many. If any new believers in faith to Christ, these churches are often said to be great at discipleship, but poorly at evangelism. Neither pattern, however, reveals churches that practice biblically faithful evangelism and discipleship." Recently, I was asked to put in my own words what the definition of what a disciple is. So I wrote this down to make it me and who I am and what God's called me to do, to be more. A disciple is a follower of Jesus Christ, sowing good habits, reaping a character, teaching others to be followers, and accepting others where they are at by building God's kingdom. So, when the gospel is preached, people repent and begin their relationship with Jesus Christ. So, we now serve as these hands and feet in these relationships. Our Christian faith happens right here. We have public relationships, which is our body of church. Our social relationships, that's our extended family, our workplace, our play areas. This personal relationship, this is our small groups. Transparent relationships, these are our deepest relationships. That's our two and three people, maybe four, that know your deepest, darkest secrets that you share with. And then there's the divine relationship. God, the direct disciple maker, that relationship you have with him. It is us being the church and the everyday missionary. This would, this world may have slowed down a little bit, right? Maybe it's even come to the point of shutting down in some areas. I can tell you right now, God's kingdom has not. Remember, our Lord is good and he endures forever. Always. So our second lesson comes from 1 Peter, beginning at the first chapter, verses 17 through 19. And remember here, it's Peter speaking. It's gospel because it speaks of Christ and good news. A letter of encouragement, a letter of evangelism. God, the great judge, sent his son to be a sacrifice. That 17th verse says, if you invoke his father, the one who judges all people impartially according to their deeds, live in reverent fear during the time of your exile. You know that you are ransomed from the fertile ways inherited from your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without defect or blemish. See, Jesus was destined before time for our sake. His glory that gives us faith and hope in God. Peter continues on here. He was destined before the foundation of the world, but was revealed at the end of the ages for your sake. Through him you can come to trust in God who raised him from the dead and gave him the glory so that your faith and hope are set in God. It's time to realize He's walking with us, even when you don't realize it. Peter again gives another proclamation. The 22nd through the 25th verses. Now that you have purified your souls by your obedience in the truth, so that you have genuine mutual love, love one another deeply from the heart. You have been born anew, not of perishable, but imperishable seed, through the living and enduring word of God. For all flesh is like grass, and all its glory like the flowers of the grass. The grass withers and the flower falls, but the word of the Lord endures forever. That word is the good news that was announced to you. We are all children of God, the new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from death, born again through the living and enduring word of God. Our baptism by the word and water, washing away the sins. We are raised with Christ in a new hope and a new life. Hope is what holds the future. Faith and hope is not something that we can see. This coronavirus, we can't see it, but we know it exists. Even in the darkness, we can see the light. Because our faith, knowing what He has done for each and every one of us. That brings me to this gospel reading that I have today that comes from the book of Luke. And I'm going to sum it up here a little bit. And they were walking these two disciples were walking from Jerusalem to a little town called Emmaus. On the third day that Jesus rose, they were walking. They had only heard. So let me read this to you. Coming from Luke chapter 24, beginning at the 13th verse and then through the 18th verse for now. That someday two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they were talking and discussing these things with each other, Jesus Himself came up and walked along with them. But they were kept from recognizing Him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk?" They stood still, and their faces were downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you only a visitor to Jerusalem and do not know these things that have happened there in these days? What things?" The disciples were asking back, "What things? Could you imagine? Where were you been?" That's what my first thought would have been. That'd be like somebody asking something like that today. Why are you wearing a mask? Why are you washing your hands all the time? Not knowing what's going on, and let her yet, not knowing who's standing next to you and asking you this. The gospel continues on here, 19 through the 24th verse. "What things," he asked, "about Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people." Powerful. "The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more is that this is the third day and all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us, and they had gone to this tomb early in the morning, but didn't find his body. They came out and told us that they'd seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him." Well, Jesus is going to go on here And he's going to be repeating these statements before his crucifixion. He would be crucified on the third day, and he would rise again. He said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe that all the prophets have spoken. Did not the Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself." Jesus scolds Cleopas and his companion as foolish and slow of heart to believe about what the prophets spoke about. Jesus then brings light to this conversation by explaining the fulfillment of the Old Testament, that our hearts burn. Our faith comes from our heart, not our eyes, but by hearing the word. The gospel continues on, and look here, the 28th to the 31st verse. It says, as they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus acted as if he was going to continue on, to go further. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it's nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went out to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread and gave it thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. And then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from them. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked to us on the road, opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with him assembled together and saying, "It's true. The Lord has risen and appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened to them on the way to Emmaus. Jesus was recognized by them when they broke bread. That's an amazing breakdown right there itself. Jesus was with them while he was with Simon, who saw them. Simon explains his story before they even get theirs out. I wonder if they crawled, walked, or ran back from Emmaus to Jerusalem. My question is for you today. Where are you at in your walk with Christ? Are you working on a personal calling to be an everyday disciple? Are you sowing good habits to reap a better character? Are you joining Jesus and picking up the cross daily? If not, I can only encourage you and pray that you will. He is walking with you already, like the disciples that didn't even recognize him. Pray and ask him to join you. Ask if you can join him on his mission. It will truly be a walk of a lifetime. In the same way, let your light shine. And with that, I like to always conclude with, God is good all the time. And all the time, God is good. Thank you. I heard you out there somewhere. And just before I'm going to ask you, before I close in prayer, I'd like to offer to those of you who are ready to make the next step into a relationship to walk with Christ, just ask him to come into your life. Just ask him for the forgiveness of any of those sins that are burning you and holding you down, because you are forgiven. His word says so. If you would like or need someone to speak to or pray for or pray with, please feel free to contact us here at Hebron Lutheran Church. Our prayer team would be glad to reach out to you and listen and pray with you. Again, thank you. And with that, I'm going to close with a prayer. Gracious God, it's so easy for me to forget how many my life was going and nowhere, and how I lived without purpose, peace, courage, or confidence. Your word gives me hope. Your son came into my life. I often fail and fall back into my old ways, leaning into my old habits and seeking my own ways. Thank you for forgiving me wherever and whenever I backslide. Thank you for walking with me. Lord, help me in all my words and actions to shine your light that can be reflected through me, off of me, to point to everyone. And with that, all God's people said, amen. All right, and I think what we'll do is the Lord's Prayer. And before I do, I'm gonna do something. I have this, because I think this is really important. This is a candle. And my message was, let's take a walk, but I'm gonna go up and light my candle. Because I think it's so important that each one of us take our candle and light it exactly like Christ has lit in every one of us. Let me see if I can reach it without. All right. Now, if I can make it back down. All right. This light. All right. If you will join with me for the Lord's Prayer. Just like he's taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And I light this candle. Go light your world. All right? And with this, let me give us a benediction or closing goodbye as we finish out multitasking here. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.